Hello friends, I am Anjana Mathur Jagmohan, Assistant Professor, Dayal Singh College, University of Delhi. I welcome you to this episode of UGC EPG Pathshala. In this episode, we are going to learn the meaning, objectives, principles, elements and processes involved in integrated coastal zone management. According to the European Commission, integrated coastal zone management is a dynamic, multidisciplinary and iterative process to promote sustainable management of coastal zones. It covers the full cycle of information collection, planning in its broadest sense, decision-making, management and monitoring of implementation. Integrated coastal zone management uses the informed participation and cooperation of all stakeholders to assess the societal goals in a given coastal area and to take action towards meeting these objectives. Integrated coastal zone management seeks over the long term to balance environmental, economic, social, cultural, and recreational objectives, all within the limits set by the natural dynamics. The word integrated refers to the integration of objectives and also to the integration of many instruments needed to meet these objectives. It means integration of all relevant policy areas, sectors, and levels of administration. It means integration of the terrestrial and marine components of the target territory in both time and space. According to Hyckoff, in its most general sense, the phrase coastal zone management could signify the public interest in managing anything and everything that goes on in the coastal zone. However, that area may be defined. In these terms, coastal zone management overlaps and includes everything that all governments already do or will do in the area. Campnet in 1989 defined integrated coastal zone management as a dynamic process in which a coordinated strategy is developed and implemented for the allocation of environmental, socio-cultural and institutional resources to achieve the conservation and sustainable multiple uses of coastal zone. The importance of the coastal zone and the need for management, the dynamic processes that occur within the coastal zones produce varied and industrial coast ecosystems which have been of great significance for human populations. Coastal margins are associated with only 8% of the world's surface area but provide 25% of the global productivity. Approximately 70% of the world's population inhabit the regions within the day's walk of the coast. 2/3 of the world's cities occur on the coasts. The factors which push the need for integrated coastal zone management are as follows: high rates of population growth, poverty exacerbated by dwindling resources, degraded fisheries inhabited, and lack of alternative livelihoods, large-scale, quick-profit commercial enterprises which degrade resources and conflict with the interests of the local people, lack of awareness about management for resource sustainability among local people and policymakers, lack of understanding of the economic contribution of the coastal resources to a society, lack of serious government follow-up in support and enforcement of conservation programs. Land-sea interactions. A major value of the integrated coastal zone management is that it addresses the land and sea simultaneously. Linkages between the dry side, which is land, and wet side, which is sea, of the coast then prevent sustainable development of coastal or marine resources without coordinated management. It is basic to coastal management to recognize how strongly activities on the land affect the condition of the sea. The sea is impacted by distant events that occur far inland. River discharges, banana plantations, deforestation, all may affect coastal ecosystems. Conversely, the sea strongly affects the land and intertidal areas. For example, pollution from tanker washings or property destruction from cyclonic storm, flooding and wave action. The countering natural defenses of the coastline, beaches, mangroves and coral reefs can be extremely important for protecting shorelines and coastal villages against storm waves and shore erosion. The objectives of integrated coastal zone management program are as follows. The overall goal of the integrated coastal zone management program is to ensure optimum sustainable use of coastal natural resources, perpetual maintenance of high levels of biodiversity, real conservation of critical habitats. The substantial objectives of integrated coastal zone management include supporting fisheries, protecting the community from storm ravages, attracting tourists, promoting public health, maintaining yields from mangrove forests, preserving coral reefs. A major objective of integrated coastal zone management is to coordinate the initiatives of the various coastal economic sectors like shipping, agriculture, fisheries towards long-term optimal socio-economic outcomes, including resolution of conflicts between sectors and arranging beneficial trade-offs, delimiting the boundaries of the coastal zone. According to McCreary Sorensen, coastal zone is the interface of transition zone and especially that part of the land affected by its proximity to the ocean and that part of the ocean which is affected by its proximity to the land. Sissin, Sain and Nest have identified five main zones within the coastal zone. Inland areas which affect the oceans mainly via rivers and non-point sources of pollution. Coastal lands, wetlands, marshes and the areas where human activity is concentrated and directly affect the adjacent waters. Coastal waters, generally estuaries, lagoons and shallow waters where the effect of land-based activities are dominant. Offshore waters, mainly out to the edge of national jurisdiction. High seas, beyond the limit of national jurisdiction. The boundaries of the coastal zone depend on political, administrative, legal and ecological considerations. A narrow coastal zone could be appropriate if its purpose were to manage only the shoreline and intertidal areas. If watershed issues are of concern, then an inland extension is necessary. Likewise, if the issues extend far seaward, then the exclusive economic zone might be included. In the case of small island countries, the whole country might be defined as coastal zone. The development of the concept of integrated coastal zone management. This concept was born in 1992 during the Earth Summit of Rio de Janeiro. The specifics regarding integrated coastal zone management are set out in the proceedings of the summit within Agenda 21, Chapter 17. At present, almost all the signatory countries have their own coastal zone management programs, each designed according to their own needs, location, and state of development. Countries of the Mediterranean, the European Union, Iran, New Zealand, Australia, Canada, many African nations and India have their own departments of coastal zone management. In India, integrated coastal zone management program is being implemented in Kerala, Andhra Pradesh, Tamil Nadu. India has also borrowed heavily from the Ramsar Convention, of which India is a signatory, to design its coastal zone management program. The concept of sustainability is important to succeed and to make the coastal zone management sustainable. The sustainable exploitation implies the wise and careful management of individual species, communities, together with the habitats and ecosystems in which they depend, so that their current of potential usefulness to people is not impaired. The principle and premises. Coastal zone management is based upon fundamental principles and all of which have to be followed earnestly. Principle 1. The coastal area is a unique resource system which requires special management and planning approaches. Principle 2. Water is the major integrating force in coastal resource systems. Principle 3. It is essential that the land and sea uses be planned and managed in combination. Principle 4. The edge of the sea is the focal point of coastal management programs. Principle 5. Coastal management boundaries should be issue-based and adaptive. Principle 6. A major emphasis of coastal resources management is to conserve common property resources. Principle 7. Prevention of damage from natural hazards and conservation of natural resources should be combined in integrated coastal zone management programs. Principle 8. All levels of government within a country must be involved in coastal management and planning. Principle 9. The nature synchronous approach to development is especially appropriate for the coast. Principle 10. Special forms of economic and social benefit evaluation and public participation are used in coastal management programs. Principle 11. Conservation for sustainable use of coastal resources management. Principle 12. Multiple use management for most coastal resource systems. Principle 13. Multiple sector involvement is essential for sustainable use of coastal resources. Principle 14, traditional resource management practices should be respected. Principle 15, the environmental impact assessment approach is essential to effective coastal management. The users of coastal zone area, which may or may not affect the coastal zone management. Coastal zone management is used for human settlement, agriculture, trade, industry, recreation, and amenities. The coastal sea presents problems related to transport, fishing, dumping, mining, etc., stemming from an intensification and diversification of ocean uses. Coastal zones are the sink for the continents. They receive and concentrate pollutants and other negative consequences of development activities taking place in the hinterlands. In particular, the flow of rivers has been severely modified for irrigation purposes, and they carry to the coastal areas the pollutants coming from the inland agriculture and industrial activities. Because general development may result in overexploitation, pollution, or alteration of natural systems, as well as conflicts between the users for limited but highly prized coastal and its shoreline space, its impact must be understood and countered. The fundamental elements of coastal zone management. These are creation of protected areas. The protected areas are coastal and marine nature reserves form a complementary and integral part of coastal zone management. These reserves can be coastal reserves, natural reserves, and or national parks. The protected areas harmonize within the objectives of integrated coastal zone management by conserving fisheries, enhancing tourism and recreation, preserving wilderness, promoting scientific and management studies. At the same time, protected areas also gain from the protection from external impact. Protection of critical habitat resources. Mangroves, wetlands, and other intertidal systems are many million hectares of mangrove forest occur in the coastal areas of subtropical and tropical countries of the world. Mangroves are found along indented coastlines where wave activity tends to be minimal. The term mangrove refers to any dozens of species of trees capable of living in saltwater and salty soil regimes. The seagrass systems. Submerged seagrasses are often abundant in the shallow waters, temperate and tropical coastal environments of the world. Seagrass beds or meadows are highly productive and valuable resources which enrich the sea and provide shelter and food for some of the most important and valued species of fish and shellfish. The coral reef systems. The coral reefs occur along shallow tropical coastlines where the marine waters are clean, clear, and warm. They are one of the most productive ecosystems of the world. The basis for the high productivity of the coral reef ecosystem is a combination of the production of the reef with support from the surrounding environment. The sandy beach systems. The beach is a unique environment occupied by animals that have adapted to the constant motion of the sand, gravel, or shell. Many important birds, reptiles, and other animals nest and breed on them and open beach, as well as feed and rest there. The estuaries and lagoons. Estuaries and lagoons maintain exceptionally high levels of biological productivity and play important ecological roles, including exporting nutrients and organic material to outside waters through tidal circulation, providing habitat for a number of commercially or recreationally valuable fish species, and serving the needs of migratory, nearshore, and oceanic species which require shallow, protected habitats for breeding and/or sanctuary for their young ones. Addressing coastal resource issues. First, loss of mangrove forest due to the rate of exploitation above that which sustain the resource. Coral reef destruction leading to reduced yield of fish species associated with reefs, reduced tourism attraction, and loss of rare ecosystems due to dynamiting to harvest fish from the reef. Harvesting of coral for construction material and, in the case of exotic coral species, for jewelry and souvenirs. Siltation and smothering of corals from erosions associated with upstream deforestation, and death of coral from deleterious effluents associated with mining or oil spills. Congestion and intensive use of coastal resources such as water, species, and fisheries due to high population density and continuing growth, expansion of tourism industry, and growth of commercial and industrial activity. inadequate institutional structures to address coastal resource problems and to administer planning, management, regulation and enforcement where it is needed. Depletion of wildlife species such as turtles, crocodiles, deer, waterfowl and manatees. Pollution of coastal waters, which adversely affects fisheries, yield and tourism revenues due to industrial waste, sewages, agricultural pesticide runoff, oil spill, bilge discharges and toxic contamination of fish, shellfish, beach and coastline erosion caused by removal of coastal mangrove forest, construction of coastal installations which alter current and wave action patterns, or mining of beaches for sand. Swampland filling that reduces fish spawning and nursery habitat and reduces fisheries yields. Upland deforestation leading to erosion and sedimentation. Overfishing leading to reduced fisheries yield and in some cases species extinction. Saltwater intrusion leading to loss of coastal agricultural lands and potable water supplies. Regulating tourism practices and recreation considering the carrying capacity of the place, introducing visitor management methods and seeking to maximize the total benefits to development while preserving the natural environments and improving the local cultural milieu upon which it depends. National security. Extensive security interests exist in the coastal zone and coastal seas because they are at the frontier, the border zone, where invasion or other negative activities might occur. Naval ports and harbors, coastal airfields and special bases of all kinds are sited in the coastal zone, usually with a high priority and intense security. However, with the correct approach, the military can be expected to cooperate in coastal zone conservation so long as it is not in conflict with the national security needs. Therefore, the defense establishment should be included as a party to any integrated coastal zone management program. Policy formulation. Essential points of integrated coastal zone management program policy formulation are: no piecemeal approaches to coastal development, rather a balance between a variety of compatible uses to maximize economic and social benefits along with conservation and development. In certain resource reserves, critical habitats and other specially designated areas might be set aside for restricted use. Environmental management through species, forms of management, of development and of resources. Integrated coastal zone management planning may result in shifts in general economic policy of a country, which might be reflected through optimizing the long-term economic benefits to society from the marine area under national jurisdiction. Decrease economic dependence on advanced countries, decrease the influence of private developers in controlling the pace of economic growth, clarify for potential investors the intentions and objectives of the government, guide development and use of the country's marine areas in a rational and efficient manner for highest and most equitable economic benefits to the people. The process of integrated coastal zone management action plan. The various steps in drawing an action plan for coastal zone management are discussed in the given diagram. If implemented earnestly, the program will need to collaborate and coordinate with different stakeholders who are involved in coastal development. These steps are triggers of the processes: initiation of formal process, feasibility studies, setting up analysis, carrying out the analysis, estimation of the demands of products and services, analyzing production, possibilities including discharge, analyzing the impact on natural systems, formulating and analyzing coastal zone management strategies and evaluation criteria, evolving evaluated strategies, presenting results to decision makers and other parties, carrying out pilot project, adoption plans, implementation and execution, monitoring and evaluation of the results and feedback. Typical economic sectors of coastal countries to be integrated and integrated coastal zone management are coastal zone or ocean specific sectors involved directly, navy and other national defense operations, for example testing, coast guard, customs, port and harbor development including shipping channels, shipping and navigation, recreational boating and harbors, commercial and recreational fishing, marine culture, tourism, marine and coastal research, shoreline erosion control, sectors rarely considered coast specific but have direct impacts. These are agriculture, marine culture, forestry, fish and wildlife management, parks and recreation, education, water pollution control, public health, mosquito control and food, housing, water supply, transportation. It is unlikely that the sectors themselves would cooperate with each other to reduce misuse of coastal resources in the absence of government intervention. Therefore, the Integrated Coastal Zone Management Program should be organized so as to encourage and guide intersectoral cooperation and activity coordination in order to achieve the goal of an integrated multi-sectoral plan. The following are some principal types of information needed for integrated coastal zone management. Physical environment data, which includes terrain data, erosional processes, storm surge, winds, tides, air-sea interaction, sediments, transport, geological setting, subsidence, sediment supply, meteorological data, climate. The biological environment, which includes primary and secondary production, major habitats and ecosystem distributions, and extent of living marine resources, presence of rare, threatened or endangered species, ecological relationships that determine productivity, and indicator species. The sociological information required is resource dependency, historical resource use patterns, including methods, factors determining historic use patterns, identity of current use patterns, identify whether current use patterns are sustainable, demographic information, land and sea tenure. The economic data required are resources and resource use patterns. They should be given economic values, quantitative values. Resource and resource use patterns that cannot be economically valued have to be considered. Specific economic pursuits like fisheries, tourism, ports, energy, settlements, transportation, aquaculture, mining, oil, gas, waste treatment and disposal, settlements, cities, traditional practices. Issues to identify the stakeholder groups involved in the use and management of coastal resources and potential conflicts among them. Institutional mechanisms, national, state and local, ministries, departments, with the division of responsibility, organization and hierarchy, legislation on zoning, pollution, resources, utilization, interagency councils, advisory panels, standing agreement with private parties, permitting and other administrative processes to carry out the legislation. Assessment of the present status of coastal zones is required urgently, including diagnostics on eutrophication, occurrence of red tides, ciguatera, coliforms at the beaches, nitrification, salinization of groundwater, fish abundance, habitat degradation levels, identification of local and upstream impacting activities like agriculture and other agriculture, wetland obliteration, etc. Using the data collected and identifying the various stakeholders as well as agencies involved, a sustainably integrated coastal zone management plan can be drawn and implemented. That is all for today. I hope you enjoyed and understood all the aspects of coastal zone management. Thank you.